evening, everyone. Welcome to this evening's event. My name is Catherine Harkup. I'm a science communicator, and I'm particularly interested in the more macabre side of science, which is why I've spent the last 18 months researching Frankenstein and the science behind this rather splendid novel. So I'm delighted to have been asked to chair this evening's event, and I'd like to welcome all of you to what I'm sure will be a brilliant evening. Before we get going, just a couple of housekeeping notes. Please, can you turn off your mobile phones or put them to silent, please? we have no planned fire alarms. However, if a fire alarm does go off, there are emergency exits towards the back and doing my to the side. this event features live subtitling. We are being live streamed and recorded, so if there's anything you miss, any details that you'd like to go back and review, the video will be available on the Royal Society website afterwards. If you'd like to tweet along to this evening's event, there is, I believe, details should be appearing behind us. Maybe. Tweet. Tonight's event is called Frankenstein Inspiring the Monster. I'm sure there'll be a hashtag or something that you can follow along to. Before we meet the rest of our panellists tonight, I'm just going to set the scene in case there's anyone in the room that hasn't read the book or isn't even vaguely familiar with it. Frankenstein is a remarkable book. In 2018, just next year, we'll be celebrating the 200th anniversary of its publication. So there will be events around the world to mark this this very grand occasion. The novel itself is about a young scientist, Victor Frankenstein, who by some means discovers the secret to life itself. I mean, pretty momentous stuff. And rather than tell the world, he decides to create a creature from bits and pieces that he obtains from charnel houses and crypts and dissecting rooms. And he manages to imbue this creature with life. He is horrified when this being begins to twitch and he flees in terror. And the creature then seeks out his master to wreak his revenge for the neglect that he feels he has experienced. So, the book is, well, I'm sure we will debate this at some point this evening, but it has been claimed to be the first work of science fiction. It was written by a 19-year-old woman, Mary Shelley, at the end of the Enlightenment period, a spectacular period in history that was full of momentous scientific discoveries, and she really tapped into this and pieced together her extraordinary story. So there were an incredible period of scientific advance. Every fashionable gathering, be it in private society, in coffee shops, everywhere, people were talking about science, particularly electricity and chemistry. It was the hot topic of the day. The Enlightenment, towards the end of the 18th century, marked the period of transition between kind of alchemy and medieval ideas of science towards the more modern interpretation, more scientific observation, experimentation that we would recognise today. So it is a truly momentous point in scientific history. The pace of developments must have been astonishing and terrifying. All these discoveries piled one on top of another. It must have been an extraordinary period to have been alive. And Mary Shelley summed it up beautifully in her novel when she had the character of Professor Waldman speaking to the young Victor Frankenstein when he's at university. And he said, "The ancient teachers of this science," said he, "promised impossibilities and performed nothing. The modern masters promise very little. They know that metals cannot be transmuted and that the elixir of life is a chimera. But these philosophers, whose hands seem only made to dabble in dirt and their eyes to pore over the microscope or crucible, have indeed performed miracles. They penetrate into the recesses of nature and show how she works in her hiding places. They ascend to the heavens. They have discovered how the blood circulates and the nature of the air we breathe. They have acquired new and almost unlimited powers. They can command the thunders of heaven, mimic the earthquake, and even mock the invisible world with its own shadows." pretty dramatic stuff. So to explore the science that inspired Frankenstein and how the novel has left a lasting cultural and scientific influence that means that we are still discussing it 200 years later, I'd like to introduce our panel. We have with us Richard Holmes, biographer and author of several books about the history of science, as well as writers from the Romantic period. We have Professor Steve Jones, Emeritus Professor of Genetics from the University College London, a leading science communicator on genetics and evolution, and author of The Ladybird Book of Evolution, Do Buy It. We also have with us Professor Roger Luckhurst, Professor in Modern and Contemporary Literature at Birkbeck University, London, and with a particular interest in monster and horror fiction. So before we get to a general discussion, I'd just like to ask our panellists to talk a little bit more about themselves and their interest in Frankenstein and the science and the context of the novel. If I could start with Roger.
Oh, OK. Well, I'm the literature professor, so I should get on quickly before I get arrested and frog marched over to the British Academy, which is on the other side of the steps, which is normally where I hang out rather than this side. So it's delightful to be on this side of the steps. I thought since I was the literature person professor on the panel, I should say something about genre, because Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is something that pleasingly annoys literary historians, I think, because it doesn't quite fit ever in genre. Is it a gothic novel? Yes, it is, I think, quite clearly. It has this amazing origin story, I'm sure we'll talk about, of Villa Diodati, so we don't just get Frankenstein that night, but also Polidori's vampire. It's constructed in exactly the way that this Chinese box structure that you get with gothic novels. It's got a classic narrative of transgression, too much knowledge, punishment of some kind or other, and of course it has a really good monster in it as well. So it is a gothic novel, but it's also profoundly not. I mean, it's the end of the first wave of the gothic, in the sense that the theological paradigm of punishment just disappears. This is what's so radical, I think, about Mary Shelley's book. It just vanishes from this. And in a sense, that's why I think many people call it the first science fiction novel, although you can't call it the first science fiction novel because that term is not operative until 1929, when Hugo Gernsback decides that the phrase science fiction is a terrible one and doesn't work, and that science fiction is much better. So it's a proto-science fiction, it's an early science fiction. The phrase that I really love that was coined by a historian of romanticism is it's neural romanticism. This sense of being at this moment, which I'm sure we're going to talk about, where actually our boundaries, two cultures' boundary, as far as they ever existed, is just not there at all. It just kind of cuts across all of these various elements. So I think that's really kind of crucial. And the other thing that I hope we can talk about is I'm really interested, yes, of course, in the biology and the genetics, proto-genetics, whatever we want to call it, of this. But also I think the medical environment seems to me a really crucial one, and that's the kind of crossover point for so many romantics. And I think part of this story is Polidori, part of this story is about the kind of medicine that they're reading. And it's also, I think, about the Shelley's friend and doctor, William Lawrence, who was writing and pronouncing about precisely a materialist conception of what the spark of life was just before they left England and just after they left England. So as Frankenstein was published, Lawrence's lectures on physiology were published and then withdrawn over this atheistical, suspiciously German approach to things, even a little bit of French. Good job we've changed our minds about all of this stuff. He had to withdraw that, but clearly that this was kind of feeding into both Mary Shelley's work and obviously Percy Shelley's work. And that kind of, that environment of just weaving in and out, of Percy Shelley going to Barts to listen to lectures by John Abernathy and meeting William Lawrence. Mary Shelley is working around that as well. That's the kind of material that I think means that it's a really interesting cross-disciplinary kind of object that makes it so perfect for us to cut across. So.
It was an extraordinary time when there was a huge crossover between arts and sciences, and there wasn't really any clear definitions. Perhaps I could go on to you, Richard.
Sure. I think the thing that really struck me, and still strikes me, is how young they all were. Mm. How young they all were. Mary Godwin, in June 1816, was still 18. Percy Shelley was 24. Byron was 28. And the one who often gets forgotten is William Polidori, who was only 21, and also Claire Claremont, who was Byron's girlfriend, unfortunately, for her.
And she was 18.
So she was, in fact, in June, she was 17. So this, the team who arrived on Diodati, which incidentally, the house is still there with a wonderful balcony. You can go and overlook the lake, and you can imagine what it was like to have electrical storms there. So it would be a real little crucible of energy with these very young people, very well read, and in a kind of secret retreat here with the famous ghost story competition, which we'll come back to. Polidori himself, I'd just like to say a word about him, because he had been at Edinburgh University at the medical school, and he'd got his thesis, his dissertation, very, very young, in 1815. Rather interesting, the Latin name is still rather impronounceable, but it's to do with sleepwalking, somnambulism, or literally translates as painful dreams, the study of painful dreams. So he was a young man who'd got this dissertation and probably brought it with him, as well as a play he was writing. Now, the important thing about him, he was there because he was employed by Lord Byron as his sort of secretary and assistant. And what Byron didn't know was Byron's publisher, John Murray, had taken Polidori aside and said, if you keep a secret journal of everything my lord does and says, I will pay you 500 guineas. So immediately you've got a kind of mystery story going on here. But one other reason why he was so important was he was the young man, the medical student who had then worked in Norwich and in London, who would have known directly about the experiments of Galvani, Aldini, about William Lawrence lecturing. So he is the direct link, I think, the first, and as we go out and see what the scientific elements were. I thought in my couple of minutes might be worth just to give you the feel of this. This is from Polidori's actual diary. Up at 9, went to Geneva on horseback and then to Diodati to see the Shelleys. Got into the new boat, they'd hired a boat, and talked till the ladies' brains whizzed with giddiness about idealism. Interesting. Okay, 15th of June. I slipped and strained my left ankle. Shelley, etc., came in the evening, talked of my play, etc., which all agreed was worth nothing. Afterwards, Shelley and I had a conversation about principles, whether man was to be thought merely an instrument, which in the language of the day would automaton. And in fact, Polidori had written quite a lot about automatons. June the 16th, laid up his bad ankle. Shelley came and dined here with Miss Claremont, dot, dot, dot. 17th of June, attempted to dance. He'd sprained his ankle, but felt such horrid pain, was forced to stop. Ghost stories are begun by all but me. Interesting thing, because Mary Shelley later says that she was the last one to start. Everybody else had started. But in Polidori's diary, they'd all started. And then June the 18th, my leg much worse. Shelley and the whole party here. Began my ghost story after tea. 12 o'clock, we really began to talk ghostly. Lord Byron repeated some verses of Coleridge's Christabel of the witch's distorted breast when silence ensued and Shelley, suddenly shrieking and put his hands to his head, ran out of the room with a candle. And so on that journal goes. So that just gives you a feeling for that moment. And last thing I want to say is, as the novel We know it in various paperback forms. It's never been out of print. But there are, in fact, three versions, and we might get back to this. There's the first one, which is really written in 1816, 1817, and it was written in two notebooks that Mary Godwin bought in Geneva. It's about 150 pages long. It's about 65,000 words, so quite short. And it's like, it is a thriller story, but all the elements are there already, including the three autobiographies, Walton the Polar Explorer, Victor Frankenstein, and The Creature. And the book is constructed out of three autobiographies, which are piled like Russian dolls, one inside the other. The second version is the 1818 one, which Percy Shelley had helped her edit. There is a sort of nefarious legend that he'd written it. Don't believe a word of it. The manuscript exists. He made some editorial corrections, and that is the 1818 version, which in a sense we're celebrating. And then there is the 1831, which went into Bentley's standard novels, and for which Mary wrote a new introduction describing, in retrospect, those events at the Diodati. So that's just to lay out a little, very simple structure.
It was a fascinating literary event, and a lot of focus has been on these sort of ghost stories that were, you can imagine the atmosphere, all these electrical storms and the ghost stories, but I think it's actually the scientific discussions that must have been going on because of the interest of all of the people there in the science that perhaps sparked this particular idea in Mary Shelley's mind. The discussion on what is the creature, I find that fascinating. What is this monster? Is it human? Is it part animal? Is it mechanical man, as you discussed? So I'm sure we'll get into that in more detail. If I can move on to you and your take on Frankenstein.
Well, it strikes, I read it, as I'm sure we all did when I was a teenager, as a story, and it's an extraordinarily good story. It's beautifully, most beautifully written. But on rereading it the other week, it struck me, what really struck me was how modern it seemed.
Yes.
And how very much alive the questions it asks are. Now, as we're in the business of advertising our books, one of the other Ladybird books which came out the other week is The Ladybird Guide to Quantum Mechanics and by a friend of mine, Jim Al-Khalili. And if you don't understand quantum mechanics, read this Ladybird book and you'll understand it even less than when you bought it. Okay. But interestingly enough, one of the founders of quantum mechanics was Schrödinger, the great physicist who lived in Dublin. And we all know about Schrödinger's cat. And that's the same question. Schrödinger's got a cat in a box with a poison vial in it, and they're throwing beams at it. And the question is the cat dead or alive? Because you can't tell. The cat is halfway between dead and alive. When you open the box, it's either dead or alive, but when it's in there, you don't know. And that's the quantum view of the universe. And Schrödinger himself, in 1933, wrote a book called What is Life? And his very important book in the history of science, because Watson and Crick read it and got the idea of what was with the code. To Schrödinger, life was very simple. Life was defined by having an inside and an outside. Okay, and that's a very, very clever observation, because what life consists of is a pool of order in a sea of disorder. And to maintain that order, you have to have a barrier. And it pumps energy in through the barrier and pumps its waste matter out the other way through the barrier. And that actually is what life is. It needs to copy itself so it has a code. Okay, so that's a rather good scientific definition of what life is. And actually, that definition is hidden away inside Frankenstein. What Frankenstein has done, which is seen as so morally reprehensible in many ways, is to take many different bits of different people and reconstitute them into a single living animal. Now, of course, as I'm sure we're all aware, most people, when they're talking about Frankenstein, they think that Frankenstein was the monster. He's a Frankenstein, but it's not like that. But if you're a geneticist, you're constantly, on a daily basis, being criticized for being Frankenstein. I wish. But of course, in some senses, what the Shelleys were concerned about, and what Polidori was concerned about, were these modern questions. Now we've got this question. What is life? When does life begin? How does animate and inanimate differentiate each other. Why did we make a fuss about stem cells? Why did George W. Bush put a ban on the use of embryonic stem cells? Now, you can't make them into a living human being, is that the question? But somehow they're more alive, because they're embryonic stem cells, than stem cells made from adults. Now, I don't quite see the logic there. That's a theological question, rather like the questions raised in Frankenstein. It goes further. There's a recent book called The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks, which is a very good book. Now, in genetics labs across the world, we can grow up cells in huge numbers. And it turns out that many of these cells descend from a woman who used to be called, we used to think was called Helen Lang, but her name was actually Henrietta Lacks, and she was an African-American woman who died of a very aggressive cancer in the 1950s. And her doctor noticed that her cells grew very, very effectively and started growing them. And now there's several, literally, there's been about 100 tons of Henrietta Lacks has been generated over those 50 years. And now, people don't say prayers when they pour Henrietta Lacks down the drain, because they're assumed not to be alive. But in some senses, they are. And the interesting thing about it, again, with a spin on Frankenstein, is that actually Henrietta Lacks turns out to be very aggressive. Her cells grow extraordinarily efficiently. People spend many, many years making cell lines, which they grow and is their precious cell line from a nerve cell. They're all Henrietta Lacks. Henrietta Lacks has invaded them and turned on them. And again, there's a spin there, perhaps, on what the monster does to his creator. So I think there are many modern ideas, which I hope we'll be able to consider. My suggestion is that we look at the science in... You can't look at any science, perhaps genetics more than anything else. I mean, I say to my first year students when I start my first year lectures, I'm a geneticist and my job is to make sex boring. And they look at me with horror. Well, I've just given them their 10th lecture this term and they know exactly what I mean, okay? And so I think it's important not when you're doing science to have the jackdaw of conscience always cawing into your ear, saying, never more, Frankenstein. We don't do that, but there is an overlap, and I kind of hope we can discuss it a bit later.
Absolutely. I think it is extraordinary how big the questions Mary Shelley was asking in this book. They're very deep, and we still don't have answers for them 200 years later. So perhaps we could start our discussion with Mary herself. How does a 19-year-old girl acquire this fantastic scientific... What sort of environment was she growing up in that enabled her to create this phenomenal work? Perhaps Richard may be a person to give us some insight to that.
Yes. Well, she was very extraordinary. Her father was William Godwin, the anarchist philosopher, and her mother, of course, was Mary Wollstonecraft, the first great feminist. And, of course, Mary Wollstonecraft died in childbirth, I think 6 days after Mary Godwin was born. So she had a striking set of parents who were both very literary. Of course, Mary had written about the rights of women and had also written a novel called The Wrongs of Women. Godwin had written not only a philosophical textbook, Inquiry into Political Justice, but also two or three thriller novels, Caleb Williams being the notable, which often dealt with questions not dissimilar to the Frankenstein story. There's one of the novels, it's about the search for an elixir of life. So Mary had inherited all this and then run away from it. She, of course, didn't go to university. Women were not allowed to go to university then, but she'd studied up in Scotland, and back with William Godwin, she met many of the leading, not only writers, but scientists of the day. So, for instance, Coleridge regularly came, William Lawrence came, and Humphrey Davy came. Humphrey Davy, the leading chemist of the age, who was the director at the Royal Institute and then president here at the Royal Society. And she looks to me as if she attended, at the age of 14, some of Davy's lectures on chemistry, and which he then published in 1812. And in fact, that passage that Catherine read
about what the scientists are doing, they weren't called scientists at that time, is almost phrase for phrase for one of Humphrey Davy's lectures on chemistry. You can run them parallel. So there's a big background of research there, and also I think the ambition, she felt she'd inherited something literary and she wanted to do something very special. And of course she'd run away with one of the hot young poets of the day, Percy Shelley, who himself had studied science at Oxford. So there's quite a mix there in the background.
And then once they get to Geneva, and added into that, we have Byron and we have Polidori, who had ambitions to write great works of not just prose, but also plays. He didn't quite achieve it, although he inspired his own literary genre. What sort of literary influences were going on at this time? Because she was surrounded by poets, but in her younger life, politicians, scientists. It was an extraordinary mix. Perhaps you could put her novel into a kind of context of what else was out there at the time.
Yeah, it is an amazing ferment that she's in London, but also in her immediate group. And I do think, just to add to that portrait, the sense of the politics of the particular kinds of science that they were interested in, so that sort of medical science, but also electrical science, was not respectable. It was a much lower form of science that was kind of demonstrated, not necessarily in the Royal Society, actually, but in pubs along the Strand, for example. So you would get, I've seen invites of in the welcome collection of, come along and see Spurzheim examine a skull in the upper room of a pub at 20, you know, the Strand at 9 o'clock in the morning. And that sort of sense of this is a radical science, an artisanal science. I think that's a very important element which feeds into the literary environment that she's involved in as well. So that sense of Frankenstein does borrow quite a lot from, I think, Caleb Williams, the novel her father wrote, the sense of persecution and a dyad of persecutor and persecuted that is so clearly picked up. There's an awful lot of sensational, fantastic, gothic horrors. I mean, they are telling ghost stories because they are reading a book called Phantasmagoria, which is, I think, complicated. It's German stories translated into French. So they're kind of trying to compete with this amazing sensation of this kind of material. And it's worth bearing in mind that people like Byron were just, they're the equivalent of, I don't know, Lady Gaga or the Kardashians, you know. What's Byron going to do next? People queuing up, selling 10,000 copies of his, you know, new poem out the door, basically, at the Strand of his publishers. So there's an incredible kind of ferment for that, but also a kind of political anxiety as well. This is the 1810s, a period of war with France, great anxiety about working class, agitation going on in England. The book comes out around the time of the Luddites, around the time of Peterloo Massacre and suppression of radical environments and so on. So there's this enormous kind of ferment and energy, I think, in the literary field as well, full of crazy people like Coleridge, translating mad things from German, godless materialists, all kinds of stuff, kind of exciting revolutionary stuff from France. An amazing ferment.
We were discussing earlier about Coleridge, because there was that brilliant quote about why he went along to Humphrey Davy's lectures at the Royal Institution quite deliberately, because...
Yes, Coleridge said, I went to...
to Davy's lectures to extend my stock of metaphors. To which Steve said, I've never heard a metaphor here in the Royal Society. yes, Coleridge, and incidentally, just to clip, one of the books behind Frankenstein, of course, is Coleridge's The Ancient Mariner, which is quoted twice in the book. The idea of the outcast, the abandoned figure, was going to be very important in when we look at who or what is the creature. So...
It was a great time for sort of scientific controversy as well. We've mentioned William Lawrence very briefly, and he's not as well known, I think, associated with the Frankenstein story. So perhaps if you could just tell us a little bit more.
So Shelley was thrown out of Oxford in 1811 for being an atheist, essentially, and he came to London and had various ideas about what he might do, and he did go to Barts to think about. He was staying with people who were training to be doctors, so he went along to see Abernathy's lectures. And William Lawrence was a demonstrator for those. He was the anatomical. He was doing anatomy demonstrations. So that's how he got into that kind of circle. But Abernathy and Lawrence got into this huge kind of vitalist controversy, really. So in other words, you know, what Steve was talking about, the very origins of life, is this a theological spark that is divinely inspired in the human body? Or is it, as Lawrence was really radically saying, life is actually the end product of an assembly of parts, really, and that it's a biological thing and life propagates life. So exactly the thing you've been talking about. So he's someone who was proposing this godless Germanic materialism, which was seen to be very, very dangerous to be an atheist is to be someone who can be prosecuted. So that sort of sense of the danger around that, huge debate going on here at this time. And I do love this idea of, I'm sure we're going to talk about Galvani, but these sorts of experiments in electrical sparking of life itself. So that happening not just with frog's legs, the famous frog's legs, but in London in 1812, Aldini was waiting for people to be executed, grabbing the bodies, because they were the only bodies you could experiment on scientifically until 1832, and then applying as much electricity as possible to see what would happen to them. And there is this fantastic description, this is from the basically the electrocution of a body of an executed criminal called George Foster. On the first application of the process to the face, the jaws of the deceased criminal began to quiver and the adjoining muscles were horribly contorted and one eye was opened. In the subsequent part of the process, the right hand was raised and clenched and the legs and thighs were set in motion. Mr. Pass, the beadle of the surgeon's company, who was officially present during this experiment, was so alarmed that he died of fright at home. So, you know, the great thing about that is that the science is gothic. You don't need to kind of think about gothic. You know, the science itself.
She could almost copy and paste. Totally. She really didn't need to add much to it.
So that kind of environment was going on.
Absolutely, and I love this idea that William Lawrence, 200 years ago, was having the idea that life itself might just be a consequence of complexity, exactly as you were saying, exactly. And not as others thought, that it was a thing. It was a bottle. You could, you know, pour it into bottles. You could extract it somehow from a body. It might even be electricity itself. Mm. And you were making the point earlier that about Galvani and his experiments on frogs using electricity to animate the muscles of clearly dead frogs. I mean, it must have been quite alarming for the general public who watched these kind of things. But the idea that the Galvani came to was that there was an animal electricity inherent within the body. We were electrical beings, but that's a very modern idea.
Well, I happen to know that there's a defibrillator in the Royal Society, which makes it clear that we are electrical beings. So if anybody's having a heart attack, please put your hand up and we'll repeat the experiment.
That's right, yeah. Yes.
Yes, that's true. But that idea of the spark of life, and that wasn't a metaphor. That was the first metaphor ever uttered to the Royal Society, possibly. The idea of the spark of life was very real. There was something about life that was outside science. Now, in some senses, of course, I believe that, we all believe that, we're not just machines. And it was very much an idea of its time. It was, in chemistry, for example, there had been the idea of phlogiston, and that when you burn something, this magical element called phlogiston left it, okay? And this was the kind of, the element of chemistry, of all substances. They had, if they could burn, they had phlogiston in them. And that was disproved by Lavoisier, of course, who did experiments in Paris 20 years before the, which I'm sure the Shelleys knew, which certainly Shelley would have known about, they were classic experiments. It was also close to the idea, which lasted much longer, of the ether, that somehow space was filled with this substance in, and the Earth was surrounded by this ether. And this, all physicists believed this until Einstein. So these are all ideas of essences which could never be approached by science, really. You couldn't find them. Interestingly enough, Marat, the guy who was stabbed in his bath by Charlotte Corday, he too experimented before Galvani did on frogs and made them twitch. And he was convinced with the phlogiston, about phlogiston. He did experiments on what he called a sun microscope, where he took the sun in and put flames and saw stuff coming off stuff burning. It was just hot air, but he thought it was the magic of phlogiston. And he grew to hate other scientists, particularly Lavoisier, because Lavoisier had disproved his ideas. And I can tell he was really quite a powerful mover in the death, the execution of Lavoisier. And I can tell you, when somebody disproves your ideas, you really do want to guillotine them. So not much has changed. So that's really, I think, you know, it's the essence of the time, really. And in some ways, science, I hate to say this, science has become less entrancing now because of the things we can do. You know, I remember there was a technique called PCR, polymerase chain reaction, which was big about 20 years ago, and for amplifying DNA. And it was the most painful, pain in the neck thing to do you could possibly imagine. You had these little tubes and on and on. And I remember showing some students this about 20 years ago, and one of them looked at me with complete contempt and said, "Oh, we did this in school." And I thought, oh, God, I give up, you know. But that's what it's become now, and you don't have to do that now. You're a little grey machine, and you press the button, and it does it for you. And you can now sequence the whole of human DNA for $1,000, okay? It took $100 million for the first sequence, and that was only 17 years ago. So, you know, it's become much more banal. I think being a scientist then was probably more exciting than it is now.
I think there was, much as there is now, there is a deliberate policy of demonstrating science and engaging a very broad audience. This was the time when the Royal Institution opened its doors. And people like Priestley, who was very involved in the phlogiston argument, as well as discovery of various gases, he was very much a proponent of, you can do this. You can be part of this whole scientific experiment. You can make discoveries for yourselves, because it was achievable. And it was an extraordinary time of everyone and anyone could get involved in science, possibly even women. It's a controversial idea. But women were starting to appear in the audiences, and it's not so surprising that a 14-year-old Mary Shelley would turn up at the Royal Institution and listen to these lectures.
That's right, yeah. And that Royal Institution is in Albemarle Street still. It's opposite Byron publisher, John Murray. Mm. And Davies' lectures were so popular, and indeed they were open to men and women, which was original then. They were so popular that the crowds jammed the street, and Albemarle Street became the first one-way street in London for that reason. So science has done something else. just while we were talking about the machines, just to bring this up to date, Galvani's machinery, Aldini's experiments, the whole question of animal electricity. There is a wonderful exhibition just going to open up the road at the Wellcome, which is called Electricity, the Spark of Life. And this has many examples of these original machines. It doesn't actually have George Foster, the criminal, being it, but it does have a lot of Aldini's equipment and the Galvani equipment, and really worth seeing, and puts it in a historical basis. But you're absolutely right, Catherine. I get the impression, too, that it was extraordinary. It was a hands-on time. Anybody could do this. Shelley, for example, always travelled around with a solar microscope so that he could observe it. Also, something close to my heart, Mary Shelley made him a hot air balloon on his birthday.
It was, I think, a wonderful time when science has become almost mundane in its ease. Very sophisticated things can be done at the push of a button. But back then, you made the equipment yourself. Priestley detailed where you could get all of the materials, and it was all very cost-effective. He wanted people to be involved in this process, and it must have felt for people reading Frankenstein, oh, I've seen this, I've seen the bodies, or I've read about it in the newspapers. It was popular discussion, perhaps even more so than science, you know, events like this and various other science communication events, modern events, even more so then. So I do love the fact that Mary Shelley could engage with her audience very directly. They would have heard about this stuff. This would have been very much their experience. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the sort of medical aspects, because medicine and anatomy was also a huge interest at the time. Anatomy schools were popping up all over the place, and it was the sourcing of the materials for these particular lectures that I think also perhaps gives a more frightening tone to contemporary readers of Frankenstein than we have today, because this was the era of body snatchers. People were polydory. If he studied medicine at Edinburgh, which he did, absolutely. He would have...
The home of body snatching, yes.
Absolutely. There are wonderful sites in Edinburgh of graves with cages over them. Mm. That is not to keep the zombies in, that is to keep the grave robbers out. Yeah, yeah. So this was very tangible and very real to her early readers, and I think it would have brought that extra kind of fear to this. So we have this creature, we have all the means, the electric. Do we think it was electricity? I mean, we've talked about electricity a lot. She's very vague in the book, and she's quite coy about the details, because I've seen the first Frankenstein film, the 1910, it's on YouTube, watch it, it's about 13 minutes, and it's like a melted clown emerges from a cauldron. It's quite creepy. Mm. The idea that it might be a sort of Promethean sort of fire spark rather than electrical, do we still give that any credibility, or are we so sold on the electricity because it was such an exciting science at the time? Do you think...
She uses the term the spark of life, particularly in there's not just one creation. There's three, because there's the original bringing together of the body parts to create not actually the monster, but the creature. And that famous chapter 5, which opens, it was a wet, drear November evening, she uses the term a great machine. She doesn't use the word electricity in that first one. And then there is a second creation scene later in the Orkney Islands, not at Ingolstadt in Europe, but in the Orkney Islands, where Frankenstein has promised the creature that he will build a second one, a companion, someone who can love the creature. Very important element in this. And in this second creation scene, it's largely chemical. There's no reference to machine there, but at the crucial moment, he decides he can't do it. He takes that moral choice that the science is going too far. And of course, the creature witnesses this. So the body is then torn apart by Frankenstein. That's the second creation scene. And out of that comes all the damage and the loneliness of the creature, because he's been refused the one thing he wants, which is love in some way, love and companionship. And science has got involved with that, committed itself to a way, and then can't carry through. The third creation scene is, in fact, in the 1831 novel, the preface that Mary Shelley writes. And she then describes how this came about, and it's in that book, the preface, that essay, that she describes having the dream and seeing in a dream the creature waking up and looking over her with yellow, watery eyes. And that's almost a quote from the Aldini experiment, where one eye opens. Mm. So just to give you the curve of that, those creations, three creations.
The second creation, I think, often gets forgotten, the female creature in the Orkney Isles. It would be an interesting alternative ending had there been two creatures. Yes. Could they have been a successful superhuman race? based, I mean, this is long before Darwin's evolutionary theory. This is a good 30, 40 years before that. There were initial ideas of evolution even then. Lamarck had recently published it and so on. It fits, when I read it, it fits in with kind of Lamarck's and Erasmus Darwin's idea of evolution, but it almost predicts evolution, competition for resources, and out-competing humans. I don't know how it resonates with you.
I think that's true. I mean, Lamarck, if you go to the Jardin des Plantes in Paris, there's a statue, and on the plinth of the statue is written, to the founder of evolution. Mm. And you look at it, and it's not Darwin. You know, what the hell is this all about? And in fact, it's Lamarck. Yeah. And Darwin himself, in The Origin, acknowledges Lamarck as the first person to realize that life could change. But Lamarck had a dramatically different view of the way that life changed. Because if he thought that life, it was a very French idea, really, he thought that life had within it the urge for perfection. That everything would strive as hard as they could until they became perfect, or at least French, which is more or less the same thing. And it was not a materialist view, whereas you can see that this was a much more of a materialist view. And that was, for that day, I think really quite a radical idea. And it's noticeable, you know, Victor says when he's thinking of making the second one, he realizes that if they mate, a new race might appear upon the earth. Yes. And he couldn't contemplate that. Now, that's rather ironic now, of course, because as we all know, and we now know quite clearly that not very long ago, 40, 50,000 years ago, Homo sapiens, the species to which many of us claim to belong, was actually mating with Neanderthals and with other now extinct forms of human. So that would have been an interesting thought. I have the dubious privilege of living in Camden Town. And I sometimes wonder whether, in fact, he didn't make a second.
Yes, there was... coming back to Lamarck and the others, Erasmus Darwin, obviously grandfather of Charles, had these ideas of everything from shells. Was that his phrase?
Ex conchilia omnia. Yes. I never quite got... I mean, that's good, because it's about snails, and I appreciate that. But Erasmus Darwin wrote this extraordinary doggerel in heroic couplets, The Loves of the Plants. And he was seen by contemporary poets as the equivalent of the great poets, of people like, you know... Keats and Wordsworth and so on. And I mean, I've written, I'm sure it's very easy to parody, I've written bits of parody of it, and it just flows out, you know. But within this particular work is a very evolutionary theory about the way in which plants reproduce. And he went to plants because he didn't really dare talk about the equivalent in animals, let alone in humans. And it's strongly evolutionary, but it's really, it's to get more boringly technical, it's taxonomic. It doesn't really have a mechanism. It simply says that this is like that, and this is like that, and this one looks a bit like that one, and so maybe they're related. And Darwin's great idea was, of course, the mechanism, which was natural selection. So I think Frankenstein is a pre-Darwinian book, but there's a whole industry of people, and I have to say I'm part of it, that spends their careers picking the lint out of Darwin's navel. You know, when did he get the idea? Who had the idea before? And you can find these pre-evolutionary ideas all over the place. And I think Frankenstein is definitely one of them.
Sticking on evolution, there's an idea in the book of a kind of internal mental evolution. Because again, it's often forgotten, when the creature escapes from the laboratory and goes into the woods, he has no language whatsoever. There's a wonderful moment, he looks up at the moon and he doesn't know the name for it, and Mary Shelley puts a footnote, a little star, saying it was the moon. He hasn't got the name for the moon. So he starts with no language and apparently no memory at all. So what's the status of his brain? We don't know, and gradually he will learn it. He will learn language by sitting outside that cottage, and then he will begin to learn history, and then he will read Milton, and then he'll read Plutarch, and then he will see the moral terrors in the world. And this is a model of a kind of mental evolution, starting from a very William Lawrence, completely blank piece of physiological organization. And gradually, Mary builds this up very rapidly. From a writer's point of view, it's a problem. She has to do it in about three chapters. Mm. But it's that internal evolution of a mind again, which brings us back again to the question of automaton. What are we dealing with?
Yeah. One of the key books, of course, that he reads is Volney's The Ruins.
Yes,
Ruins. Was written in 1791. So 2 years after the French Revolution, and is a reflection on the stupidity of mankind set in Palmyra, of all places, in the ruins of Palmyra, and is a kind of meditation on the collapse, inevitable collapse of all empires. So that sort of sense of radical science, radical politics, all as a kind of continuous flow, I think. So that sort of evolution is radical at every level, scientifically and
politically. The growth of the creature from living in a forest to going to a community, learning from it, parallels almost exactly the early stages of Volney's work. It's extraordinary the number of things she managed to tap into and layer into the what is on the face of it a very simple, pacey drama. That I think there's an awful lot more to it. You've hinted, Steve, about what Frankenstein has left us as a legacy, perhaps not always, from a scientific point of view, perhaps not always favourable. When I read Frankenstein, I read Victor's achievement as a scientific success. It's phenomenal what he achieves. It's his lack of care afterwards that is his downfall. It's not science gone wrong or science gone mad, but that seems to be the modern interpretation we've taken on of the novel, and it's perhaps the scientific legacy that it's left us.
Yes, it's certainly when it comes to genetics, it still hovers over the science to some extent. But, you know, I often think, you know, as a geneticist, the four letters of DNA, A, G, C, and T, they should be rephrased as H, Y, P, and E for hype. Okay, when you ask yourself what can genetics actually do to better the human condition or to cure human genetic disease, the answer is very, very little. It can do marvelous things in farming and animal breeding and so on. It can do quite a lot in diagnosing particular diseases, but when it comes to curing them, really, I have to say there's very little there. And when I look at some of my colleagues, not my colleagues, I mean the ones at Oxford and Cambridge, of course, you know, they've been blathering on about everything is going to change, and when Blair and co announced the Human Genome Project, they said, what was the phrase he used? After this, nothing will be the same. I can tell you everything. After this, everything is exactly the bleeding same. So I think you need to separate science fact from science fiction. Science fiction you can make up. And, you know, it's a wonderful, wonderful book. Science fact is much, much flatter and more tedious.
Not disappointing, but a realistic note, perhaps. Maybe we could open the discussion out to our audience who've been laughing along with us. Oh, there's a question just over here, gentlemen.
And we have microphones as well.
Yes, if you could just wait for a microphone. They're speeding towards you at the moment. If I go to you first, sir, and then if I go to gentleman with the red tie, if I go to you second.
Stephen Minger, ex-Kings. Stephen, you know, I love your work. I always have. But I really have to take some umbrage at some of your comments. I mean, you know, we live in a world where scientific achievement is moving so much faster than we can even anticipate. And I take your comments about, particularly around genomics. I think it's a very unidimensional way of looking at disease when there's so many other influences with, you know, things like the microbiome and metabolomics and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But when you say that science has become mundane, do you really believe that? I'm quoting you, because that's what you said. I think we're living in a world where science is accelerating so fast that those of us, you know, who have been around for a long time, and I would put you and I sort of in that same age category, you know, where the science is just progressing so very fast that we can barely keep up with it. So I don't think it is mundane, and I would, that's the point of this question. Do you really believe that?
I think the science is not mundane, but I think what the science can do, I'm talking particularly genetics. I remember speaking to Sidney Brenner, which, well, Brenner was one of the, was perhaps the greatest of all that generation, Watson and Crick. He worked out the genetic code, and he's still alive. He's very, very old now. I remember speaking to Sidney Brenner 10, 15 years ago, and he said, Sidney, he was a very amusing character, he said, Steve, if any science adds the phrase omics to the end of it, it's dead. And I have to say, I kind of agree with him. But I mean, I don't want to put down my own science, far from it. It's a fascinating science, particularly the snails part of it. But I think it's the public perception of it which I try to damp down.
Perhaps don't believe all the hype. Gentlemen, just in the middle, red tie. Oh, there we go.
Picking up on another one of your points, Steve. You mentioned... Oh, I'm not picking on you, sorry. You said... The difference between science and science fiction. Science fiction is, you know, a lot more interesting than science fact. We're living in a post-factual world. How does the layman tell the difference these days between science fiction and science fact? Everything's hyped.
Well, the irony is really, I mean, I read a great deal. I read many non-fiction nowadays, but I've read many, many heavy novels. And the one genre that I really can't stand is science fiction. At least modern science fiction, it just seems to be silly, most of it. And, you know, things like the time machine, that's not silly because it's an ingenious idea. You see utopia appearing and then disappearing and so on. But the sort of, you know, it's basically the Wild West with rockets, most of it. So I just find that unsatisfying. So I can't answer your question is the answer. The point about science, I mean, you know, I once wrote and got into trouble for saying it. How did it go? I once wrote that philosophy is to science as pornography is to sex. It's cheaper, easier, and some people seem to prefer it. That was in the book review. The author was not happy about it, I can tell you. But it's very difficult to know what the scientific method actually is. There's much argument about it. And I'm not interested in philosophy. But one of the touchstones is that any science fact is disprovable. And if you disprove it, then I'm afraid it's wrong. Now, the Earth is not 6,000 years old. So when I get, as I often do, emails saying, will you come and debate the age of the Earth with our creationist society, I say, no, I'm wasting my breath. But every science fact is disprovable. I'm waiting for the headline that says, DNA is not the genetic material. Okay, and we're not actually that far away from that in some senses, because now we know that DNA is only one very small part of an extremely complicated system. So I think that is the difference. I like things to be disprovable.
Yes, just there, and then we'll come to you afterwards.
I'm interested in what the panel think about what Mary Shelley thought she was doing. You've talked about how the story that's told about Frankenstein now is this hubristic sort of Faustian tale of, you know, science exceeding its proper bounds, and to some degree it seemed that in the second edition of the book, Mary Shelley, when she was older, maybe more conservative, she played up that moral. But it seems to me that the reason we're still talking about the book now is that it permits so many different readings. Which do you think, if any, Mary Shelley in 1818 intended us to have?
I think this is a good question to then kind of respond and give Steve a reading list about science fiction you should read now. Because I think there is a kind of sense in which you're right, that science fiction is not about prediction. If you try and read it for kind of scientific accuracy, then it's always going to fail unless it's two or three texts. You know, it's H.G. Wells' The World Set Free, predicting to the year when nuclear power would happen. And it's Astounding Science Fiction magazine being raided by the FBI in 1945 for apparently revealing the Manhattan Project. So these are kind of famous instances of prediction, and that's right. But what it does is it thinks proleptically about the possibilities that are available. So my sense is that what Mary Shelley is seeing is she's not saying electricity is the spark of life. She's seeing a whole range of sciences, electrical experiments, galvanism, which of course animal electricity is not the same, mesmerism, and animal mesmerism, this kind of sense of a magnetism that might be an electrical force, which was also bound up with, you know, mental education and evolution and so on. And in the middle of that, she is deliberately vague because it allows you then to go into lots of different routes to it. So what science fiction does is it gives you narrative possibilities, possible coherences of an age of massive acceleration. So to go back to that, I mean, it's called the Great Acceleration now, isn't it? There's the scientific moment. And you can go to science fiction to look for plausible or implausible narrative possibilities of what it might mean to be living in a post-singularity world. So that sort of sense of the possibilities there, that's why we're still talking about it, is because it doesn't say life is electrical, because that would be wrong. What it does is provide you a fantastic imaginative proleptic projection of what might happen. And that's why we're still talking about, there was a book that came out less than 10 years ago by a sociologist of science, Nicholas Rose, called The Politics of Life Itself, which was basically about Frankenstein still, even though it's about genetic engineering. So I think that's what science fiction can do. It's not about prediction or accuracy. It's about possibility, as you suggest.
Yeah, two parts of answer to your question.
What do I think she was doing, Mary Godwin, Mary Shelley? I think the centre of the book is not those moments, those two moments of creation. The first one occupies two paragraphs. The centre of the book is when the creature confronts his creator in the mer de glace, where Mary had gone with Shelley, up in the ice floes. It's still very bleak up there. And the creature comes to Frankenstein and says, "You gave me life, but I'm ugly, you've taken no care of me, everybody is cruel to me, I am totally lonely. You're responsible, take responsibility." That's a whole chapter on that. And more than that, the language that the creature uses is quite different from that of Robert Walton, the explorer, or Frankenstein himself. In his own autobiography, it's pitched in a completely different way. It's operatic. It's like an aria. And what he's claiming is human rights. This is the key thing, justice, human rights. And he's claiming it from Frankenstein. Now, I think that is the center of the novel, in fact, although it's necessary to have the other things structured around it. Second part of my answer, what we're talking about, the imaginative influence, not necessarily science fiction, just worth bearing in mind, the first thing that made the book popular was not the book, but a theatrical melodrama called Presumption, or The Fate of Frankenstein, which appeared at the English Opera House in 1823. Every night, the audience was larger than the total readership of the first edition of the book. 500 or 600 people every night came. Mary came back from Italy, was in the audience, and said, "I've had a great success, and many ladies fainted in the audience." Wonderful, a hubbub suit. So, and that dramatic, of course, goes right on to the films, which we barely got time to discuss, but there are 70 or 80 of them. The James, you talked about the 1910 very early one, the James Whale with Boris Karloff, which is 1931, which is, of course, the anniversary of the 1831. And then maybe I pick out the Kenneth Branagh, 1994, which also deals with the question of the second creation, the attempt to create a woman. Now, the thing about those, I think they get better, but again, the creature barely speaks in the films, yeah. Particularly Boris Karloff. Grunts, whereas Mary gave him this wonderful language. It's the most powerful language in the novel. And again, it's a language of human rights. And just to finish off, not necessarily science fiction, I think many of you here must have been to the Danny Boyle production in, when was it, 2011, here at the National Theatre, completely with that extraordinary birth scene and so on, and the two, Johnny Lee Miller and Benedict Cumberbatch, exchanging the roles of Frankenstein and the creature. A very interesting take on it. There's been a ballet, I think last year, here at Covent Garden, by Liam Scarlett, I think, who also gave a very, he said, I think this myth is about love. He went to that, love rejected. And that's what the ballet is about. And maybe as a last shot, very interesting play by Tom Stoppard called The Hard Problem, which is about the notice and the notion of what is consciousness, which is partly the Frankenstein problem. What kind of consciousness does the creature have? So I would include all those in the imaginative effect of this quite extraordinary book started by a woman who was 18 years old. Amazing, amazing.
Yes, of course, agree with that, absolutely. The subtitle, if I get it right, is The Modern Prometheus, isn't it? And there's certain elements of Milton in there, Paradise Lost.
Yes.
And actually, that's another, I mean, we don't want to, that's another sort of theme here, which is the Old Testament says, as the serpent says to Eve, if you eat of this fruit, you should be like gods, knowing of good and evil. And that's, of course, what Victor Frankenstein wanted to do. He wanted to be like a god, knowing of good and evil. And so it's a very theological book in that sense, although it does drift away from it in the end. I think he finally realizes that he has been a god, and he pays the price for it. So there's that other theme of it, too. Mm. And I was glancing at some of the literature on this the other day, and I hadn't realized, I'm sure you're very familiar with it, I hadn't remembered, that Mary Shelley had a baby, yes, which had died.
Yes. Mm.
And she talks very touchingly of dreaming that the baby had come back alive again. Before she was, how old was she then? 17?
Yes, yeah, 16.
Even 16.
Yeah.
That too, I think, is part of this story, that she wakes up and the baby was gone. So I think if it wasn't a science fiction novel, a great science fiction novel, it would be a great novel.
I think you've gone on to the territory that I was really wanting to come back to, that the question in the novel is not what is life. It's not an assemblage of organs and limbs sewn together and then zapped with electricity. It's where is the self? Where is the agency that has rights, needs, wants, desires? And Victor did not foresee that he was going to bring into being an agent with needs and wants and desires and rights. And that was, he didn't foresee that, that was the tragedy.
I think that's the interesting point, the lack of foresight of, I'll build a brilliant creature that's super strong and huge and visually very striking, and then I'll run away.
Yeah. Well, it's a novel about, I mean, like so many Gothic novels, of really extreme sensibility, isn't it? So there's that sense of, it's a very exaggerated version of an immense attraction to something that as soon as you achieve, you have immense repulsion to, which is a kind of narrative that some people have about, some psychoanalysts have about desire, that sense of, once exactly what you achieve, what you get, you are repulsed by it. And that sort of, that really exaggerated version of the sensibility there is right. But I would emphasise, I think, what Richard was saying about this sense of, it's coming straight out of the French Revolution, this sense of a demand to be recognised by the other, that you are a self, that you have rights, but also a subjectivity. So that sort of sense of again, the radicalism of that political kind of demand is coming straight out of the political environment of where Mary Shelley is writing. So I think that's really important too. It feeds into exactly what you're saying.
I think think the majority of the criticisms in the reviews of Frankenstein were about the Godwinian revolutionary theories, much rather than the horror or any kind of graphic detail of the novel itself. It was the ideas and the sense of responsibility.
And this is why she kind of writes that down a little bit in the 1831 edition. She does sort of suppress certain elements of the radicalism perceived in the 1810s. So she kind of learned a lesson. So, of course, what William Lawrence did, you know, William Lawrence by 1819 was basically facing ruin. So what did he do for the rest of his life? Become an utterly respectable member of the Royal College of Surgeons until he was its president, got his baronet, then died 40 years later, having said nothing radical since 1819. So in a way, that sort of that was a model for how Mary Shelley might become a respectable literary figure. Of course, Wordsworth did it too.
This question just in the middle, gentleman with the blue shirt.
I'm just interested in how far away current scientists think they are from putting together a bunch of healthy body parts into a creature, and actually thinking about that, how far away scientists were in 1818 from thinking that, and whether it's actually the same amount of time.
Asking for a friend.
Well, my perception is that In 1818, they probably thought they were closer to it than we think we are now, which isn't to say that remarkable things can't be done. I mean, we all know about these babies with three parents, where you insert the extra bit of DNA into what's called the mitochondrion into the fertilized egg in order to replace the damaged mitochondria, which caused terrible problems later in life. So, I mean, that's quite remarkable, but that's a very, very long way from creating an actual creature. There have been attempts with bacteria to make them what's called the minimal genome. Craig Venter, that Frankenstein figure, has actually taken little bacteria and snipped bits out of them and made them smaller and smaller and smaller to see what the minimum amount of information you need to make a viable bacterium is. And I've forgotten what the figure is, but it's remarkably low. But that's a long way from making a multicellular creature. And I think, you know, I'm not going to do it next week.
There are chemists who have gone in the other direction. They've gone from what's the minimum chemically that we can squeeze together in some kind of spherical container and get it to reproduce itself.
Well, I have a colleague who's doing exactly that.
It's remarkably difficult, from what I understand.
He's a very un-Frankenstein figure. I bet he's an extremely able guy, but I'm sure that no moral qualm has crossed his mind for a moment. He's trying to generate life.
I think we're
I'll let you know
safe.
If he succeeds.
Yes, do. I think at the time it must have been a much more frightening prospect. The power of science did seem almost within reach. The fact that it's always almost just within reach is perhaps the appeal of the book as well, even today. There's a question just at the back, yes?
Okay, thank you. Do you think it's fair to say that Mary Shelley was using the science around her at the time to make a political comment on this idea that scientific ambition was a purely male aspiration or characteristic?
I speak with no expertise. I wouldn't have thought so. What you tend to forget is, with very few exceptions, Humphrey Davy was one of them, is that what actually drove being a scientist wasn't your gender, but your bank balance. You know, no, the word scientist hadn't been invented then. But it's very noticeable that many of the great scientists of the 19th century and before were people of considerable affluence. I mean, Darwin was worth about £17 million in modern money when he died. And Thomas Henry Huxley was Darwin's great supporter, complained that he couldn't make a living as a scientist. Mind you, we're now more or less back to that, I have to tell you. Certainly there was a gender... There was a gender bias, but that was so all pervasive then that I would, you know, I mean, her mother, of course, wrote on the rights of women. I'm sure she was very, very well aware of it. I'm not convinced that the absence of women in science was part of that. I don't know, but I think she had a much wider view, and she was, of course, absolutely right, on the exclusion of women from the intellectual world almost entirely.
And there's quite a strong argument amongst feminist critics of the Gothic that actually the Gothic is nearly always about male anxiety about reproduction, and that that is full of these kind of, you know, horrific fantasies. I mean, if you're talking about Prometheus, we're thinking about Ridley Scott and Alien and that sort of sense of, you know, total fear of male birthing. And it's certainly the case that the first wave of the Gothic from 1760s onwards is about inheritance, but not in a biological sense, but in a financial sense. You know, it's who owns what and how has it gone wrong, and can you re-establish a patriarchal line with the money? It's basically what happens in the first Gothic novel. So I think there is something that Mary Shelley is picking up on, and perhaps a little bit like her mother, critiquing a little bit, and also using her father's narrative framework and critiquing that, having challenged his own quite ironically conservative sexual mores, you know, that sort of sense of a critique going on there, as well as, you know, mentioning her multiple losses of children actually at this mm-hmm. point, and the suicides around her of the women that were associated with these libertines, Shelley and Byron. So I think there is quite a lot of gender politics in there actually, not necessarily about the science though.
Yes, I think the answer to your question is yes. How could the daughter of Mary Wollstonecraft not have that in mind when she wrote? It's also interesting to actually consider, of course, she published that first edition anonymously. In the 1831 edition, she had darkened the view of science, and it looks much more threatening in the 1831 edition. But at the same time, and she was aware of this, that there, women in science were beginning to have an impact. And the person I pick out, because the date is very relevant, is the Scots mathematician Mary Somerville, who published her On the Connection of the Physical Sciences, the first great popular science book. Wonderful book, still in print now. In the same year, I think it's 1831 or 1832. And she was married to a fellow of the Royal Society here and had a dazzling career, which took her abroad, scientific. And she then drew some of the first American women scientists, Mary Mitchell, first professor of astronomy at Vassar, came over to Europe to meet Mary Somerville and had a very rough ride in the common room of Trinity College, Cambridge. But so this was going on, and Mary would have been aware of that. And I have to say, I think it's a bit of history that is still not realized enough, how powerfully this was going on. William Herschel, the great astronomer, his sister, Caroline Herschel, published the first woman's paper here in the Transactions of the Royal Society, which was on the discovery of a comet, and she went on to discover six of them. So that was building, although, of course, it has to be said, no woman could be a fellow of the Royal Society until a certain date in the 20th century. It was the same in America, it was the same in France, it was the same in Russia. If you go downstairs now, you will see everything has changed. You will see the pictures on the wall. So the answer is yes. I think very strongly she felt that. And I don't entirely accept the fact that in later life she became all that conservative. She wrote interesting lives of some scientists. She kept afloat as a woman writer, which was quite exceptional then. So I think it's interesting. And of course, she signed the book in the end, which was dedicated to Godwin herself. So it's a bit of lost history, and I think once again this novel points us towards something about what we should be discussing really today, the role of women in science.
Just a little point before I go to the next question. Women were generally not accepted in doing science, but at that time there was emerging a role for women to communicate science and write books, yes, about science. Mrs. Marcet,
Jane Marcet, yes,
wrote a brilliant book about chemistry that was deliberately for educating girls and boys in the sciences. So there was a role, perhaps, for Mary in discussing the science, but perhaps not being a participant in the direct sense. But anyway, that's a slight addition. A question just at the front.
Hi, I kind of want to go back to the theological aspect that you were talking about before. So the evolution of Frankenstein, so he started off with no language and then was able to move on from there to finally confront, like, his maker. And I was just thinking, so with the whole idea of atheism, is that almost like the evolution of man? They weren't able, they got to language, got to questioning, and then finally to the point where they started looking for those answers for life. It's almost like Shelley's sort of
challenging
like the maker kind of thing, and whether through that questioning those ideas of science were able to evolve in that way where people were a bit more bold to be able to do that due to having this sort of idea in a way.
Were people starting to challenge the divine word at this, certainly in print, I think they were starting to.
Yes, I mean, I would have thought immediately, again, at same, almost the same date, is Charles Lyell, a great two-volume book on geology, and you were quoting the 6,000 years, and he was the one who said, you're joking, because he'd studied the systems throughout Europe, volcanic systems and so on, and he made, at least beginning to be popular, the idea that it wasn't a mosaic flood and so on, but geology could take us and give us these dates. Now, that book, again, was published 1831, 1832, same time as the Mary Somerville. So, but it was also complicated because I think very few of those, certainly the young Victorian scientists, wanted to challenge Christian theology directly. They often, like Herschel, just rode gently over it and referred to the great intelligence and so on. And it's, I would have thought, but Steve will know about this, 1859, the reception of Darwin, then the challenge really begins. But would that be right?
That's kind of right. I mean, it's the famous debate in Oxford with Wilberforce. Martin Rees, the last but one president here, used to describe himself as a non-believing Christian. Yes. I could never quite understand that, I have to say. But he was president of Trinity College, Cambridge, so I suppose he had a bad attack of crossed fingers most days. Yes. Now, Darwin was interesting because in the origin, the first edition, the word evolution doesn't appear, but the word evolved is the very last word of the book. But in the second edition, I can't remember the exact phrase, but in the last but one sentence, under God, it says, and that was Darwin's wife, who was herself a very strong believer, and she really couldn't cope with the idea that there was no mention of an external religious presence here. But Darwin, in his later life, it was quite clear that he was, if not an atheist, at least an agnostic. And I think he was posthumously very annoyed to be buried in Westminster Abbey.
I was thinking of, when you were talking about these ideas of challenging God, about Percy Shelley, who famously wrote in a hotel register, Percy Shelley, atheist. And it was other people, it was Byron who came along after him and scratched it out. He wasn't worried at what the world thought of him, but other people were worried on his behalf. Yeah. Yeah. So maybe there was that kind of idea in many shows.
I mean, I think we have to go between... So we mentioned Joseph Priestley earlier, and there's that famous preface he wrote where he basically said that that theology is going to have to give way, and that, to quote him, the hierarchy has every right to tremble at an air pump. So that sense of this practical science is going to do something. But even after 1859, that's the kind of, that is a really crucial moment, but it's even in 1874, when Tyndall is speaking at the famous Belfast address to the British Association of the Advancement of Science, he does say explicitly, on these matters, science now has authority over theology, and the whole world went mad. This was just complete transgression. People were still being prosecuted for atheistical publications in the 1880s. So it's still an issue.
Yeah, but I definitely think you can see early origins of that challenge around Erasmus Darwin and from then on. There was a question just here.
If there's a scientist stood over a body tonight that they can bring back to life, do you want them to?
Is it David Bell?
I inevitably would say Charles Darwin.
There's a different form of this question, which is, if you were going to organise a dinner party with three people, who would you bring back? All right. I've heard various kinds. One, somebody said the three Bronte sisters. Bronte sisters. Interesting. Somebody else said Scott Fitzgerald, Ernest Hemingway, and Edmund Wilson, because we would all drink a great deal and have a fight. sorry, flippant answer. What would you...
Well, I mean, this story has been told many, many times in Gothic. It makes me think of Edgar Allan Poe's story about the mesmeric, the guy who's at the moment of death is suspended in mesmeric trance for 9 months and can speak, therefore, from beyond the grave. But what he says is so horrifying that they just immediately finish him off and he crumbles into dust. So that sort of sense of not wanting to hear precisely what is beyond the grave is a kind of, it's a classic Gothic trope, actually. So maybe not.
I think if I could choose, I might choose Henry Cavendish, not nearly as well known as I feel he should be, and earlier experimenter on torpedoes and electric fishes and all sorts of things that he was just too shy to tell anyone about. And consequently, lots of other people have their names attached to discoveries that he made. And I'd love to, I doubt I'd be able to do it, but just coax him, please publish something, please. He'd possibly hate me, so I don't think it would go well.
Would it just be worth, sorry, just adding, there is a literary form which does that, which is biography.
Yes.
And it is very powerful now because it can write about science and literature and art, and it can bring this together. So it is a form which doesn't bring back from the dead, but it somehow reanimates and makes the dead important again. As Michael Holroyd, the great biographer, said, it gives the chance of the posthumous to write one last work and be useful. Right? So I seriously mean that. I think biography is a wonderful instrument. I would think that, but of course, but which can deal with scientific subjects, artistic, literary subjects, and get rid of this terrible idea of two cultures that don't talk to each other.
Absolutely. I think that's a wonderful point to conclude this evening. I hope we have managed to combine the two cultures somewhat this evening. It's been a fascinating discussion. I hope you have all enjoyed it. Thank you very much for participating. A safe journey home. Thank you very much indeed.